Thank you. From the book of Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, share your bread with the hungry and bring the homeless poor into your house. When you see the naked, cover him and do not hide yourself from your own flesh. Then shall your light break forth with the dawn and your healing shall spring up speedily. Your righteousness shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry, and he will say, here I am. If you take away from the midst of you the yoke, the pointing of the finger, and the speaking wickedness, if you pour yourself out for the hungry and satisfy the desire of the afflicted, then shall your light rise in the darkness and your gloom be as the noonday. The word of the Lord.
Light rises in the darkness for the upright. A light rises in the darkness for the upright.
A light rises in the darkness for the upright.
A light rises in the darkness for the upright. He is generous, merciful, and just. It goes well for the man who deals generously and lends, who conducts his affairs with justice.
A light rises in the darkness for the upright.
He will never be moved. Forever shall the just be remembered. He has no fear of evil news. With a firm heart, he trusts in the Lord.
A light rises in the darkness for the upright.
With a steadfast heart, he will not fear. Open-handed, he gives to the poor. His justice stands firm forever. His might shall be exalted in glory.
A light rises in the darkness for the upright.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. When I came to you, brethren, I did not come proclaiming to you the testimony of God in lofty words or wisdom, for I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and in much fear and trembling, and my speech and my message were not in plausible words of wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and power, that your faith might not rest in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. The word of the Lord. Gospel acclamation.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. At that time, Jesus said to his disciples, "You are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trodden underfoot by men. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor can do men light a lamp and put it under a bushel, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven." The Holy Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Our Lord is talking to his disciples, his apostles. He has just finished having an address with them in the mountain. They are now come down into the level ground. And he's giving them another teaching to enrich them, to empower them with what he had told them in the mountain. And it uses two analogies, using salt and light. What is the purpose of salt? Basically, why do we use salt? We know each one of us that salt gives a taste. Where there is no salt in the food, there is no taste, except those who have been ordered by doctors not to take salt. And because it gives a taste, we are able to eat and eat and be happy eating that which has been put salt, food. The same way, those of us who have been there for some time, we know salt is used to heal. If you cut somewhere, either part of your body, and you put salt, salt is able to dry the blood from oozing, which means salt is also used in healing. Jesus says that you are the salt of the earth. Telling his disciples, he's also telling us, we are a salt of the earth. Salt in terms of what we say. Do you draw people to Christ through your words? Or are you taking people away from Christ? When what you say, what I say, that does not draw people to Christ, my life is saltless, which the Lord says, it is good for nothing. That which is good for nothing has no purpose being in place. In our families, are we salt to our children, parents? Are you salt? Do you give taste to your children? Are you likable to your children? Do they like you? Do they love you? Are you likable to your wife, to your husband? By the manner in which you handle yourself to each one of you, husband, wife, is there love between life of husband and wife? Do we recall that moment when you told your wife, "I love you with more or my with all my heart," and you said, "You'll be mine until death do us part"? There was so much sweetness in the terminologies and ones you are using when you are quoting somebody. What has happened now? Where is that salt which you used through your mouth? Was it emanating from the heart, or it was just mouth speaking? Do people say, when they see us, Catholic Christians, do they say, "See, that is the man of God. See, that is a woman of God. See, that is a youth of God"? By the manner in which we expose, we demonstrate our life. I think our Lord is challenging each one of us that we must be salt to wherever we are. Are people happy when we meet them in the workplaces where we work? Or they say, "It is better that he has not come to report today, because of the manner in which you handle your workers."
The man you and those who are working in your house, they say, oh my goodness, let them not come early. Let she not come early because of the way we handle them. Do we handle human beings as people of God with the image and likeness of God? I think, my dear people, we might lose heaven if we don't handle people well. The first reading has it all. It says this. God speaks to his people through prophet Isaiah, and he says, feed those who are angry, and then clothe those who are naked, and then shelter the homeless. If you do this, then the light will rise in darkness, and your gloom will be as the noonday, which our Lord also has said in Matthew chapter 25, verse 31 to 40. Whatever you do to my brothers and sisters, you are doing unto me. When you feed those who are hungry, you are feeding me. When you love anybody, because he is created in the image of God, you are loving me. That is to be salt. The second analogy is about the light. Our Lord tells his disciples, you are the light of the world. Christians are the light of the world. Our Lord noticed that there is so much darkness in the life of men, and so he had to make his disciples shine so that people seeing their good work, the Bible says, they will give glory to the Father who is in heaven. Am I light to my people? And I want to demonstrate it with a few ideas or a few questions. And these questions, I direct them to the parents. Parents, you are supposed to be light to your children. Are you light to show children that they should read the Bible, the Word of God? Parents or teachers? When you go home, ask that question. If you say you as a parent, you are supposed to show your children the need to read the Word of God, do you even open the Bible to read to your children? But of course, the parents will tell me, but you know, Father, these children come home very tired and they have a lot of homework. So they only eat very fast, go to do homework and sleep. Now, what is important? What is of value? Is it the Word of God or the homework or coming tired and eating, doing a bit of some homework and sleep? Who directs your children in doing the homework? Are you the one or God himself in his word? Why don't you put on norms in your house and say, at least twice a week, it may not be every day. Twice a week, and especially on weekends, that the law in my house is that we have to read the Word of God, and we shall rotate. Today it is you, tomorrow the other one, the other day is me, the other day my wife. And you see, your house will become like a church where the Word of God is shared because it is food. The last question. Who is supposed to show children? Remember, I'm not saying teach children. I am saying show children that they must go to church. Parents or a teacher? Of course, this time around, we want to make our children very happy, and we want to listen to them tell us anything. If they ask for money, we just dish money. We don't know where they are taking money. And we are spoiling our children, my dear people, by listening to them and, you know, doing what they want you to do. It is like they are commanding you. In fact, they are more superior, they are more powerful than you are. If whatever they ask, you just dish it out. I would wish it this way. If I got married, I don't think my children will refuse to come to church in as far as they are under my roof. Some might tell me, you know, but you know, Daddy, I don't feel like going to church. Allow me to sleep. I think I would be a very tough man. You go to church first. If you don't go to church first, go away and don't come back home. Of course, they will prefer to come to church. They better come to church anointed and sit at the back part of the church. Come to church, but you have obeyed me. And of course, again, I have to show my children by example. Coming to church, in fact, I would be the last person to leave home and go to church, and I'll make sure I'm not late when my children have gone before me. Or we go together. If we allow our children to command, to direct, to regulate, to do what they want in our life as parents, we will be missing the point. When you direct your sons and daughters towards godly way of life, you are becoming the light, you are becoming the salt to the earth. That is how Jesus is telling his disciples. The last point. As parents, we must show examples to our children. I don't think a good parent should be able to abuse the wife or the husband in the presence of children. It is wrong and very wrong to talk harshly to each one of you in the presence of your children, because you are teaching them that this is the way of life. When you marry, abuse your wife, abuse your husband. That is the way of life. I have now twisted from showing to teaching. Teaching means you are directing people and they see your children, they see what you are doing. If I am used to coming home drunk, I am telling my boy, men, when they marry, they should go drinking and come home late, drunk. Whatever we teach our children by the way and the manner of life, that is how they are going to take it. My dear people of God, my prayer is become light and salt, primarily, first and foremost, to your children, and then extend it to your place of work, extend it in your businesses, extend it elsewhere. How wonderful it is when you are doing business and somebody comes to buy something and you are selling with a smile. Oh, what do you need? I need this. Oh, please have it. It costs. Okay, then you start negotiating with a smile, not with a gloomy face. You become light and salt to whoever has come to buy something in your shop. We can talk and talk about salt and light until cows come home. But for now, be challenged that what we do, it's a teaching in itself. What we do, show others that this is how things are supposed to be. The end result is, let your light so shine before men and women that they may see your good works. Not just work, but good work. I have remembered something. As a seminarian, I just finished seminary. And you know, before we release them to go home, when they finish, we do intensive assessment about their way of life. How has these students been? And we base our assessment on three things. Number one is spiritual. Number one is extracurricular activity like manual work. Number four, liturgy. So one students from where I come from, he finished last year. The assessment was not good because he was cheeky. He was very cheeky. Sometimes disappearing at night and coming back. So he called the diocese that, do you know somebody and so and so? How does he behave in the diocese on holidays? The director of vocations told us, this man has a number of issues. But then allow him to finish his school, we shall adore him when he comes to the diocese. Last year he went home, he was given the first phase of the pastoral work. It is divided into two. 6 months, one parish, 6 months, the other parish. Now, he was told to go and work with the bishop. That is the toughest job. That is the toughest you do to us, even a priest, is to be transferred to go and work with the bishop. You know, bishop, they wake up at 5 for prayers. So as a priest, I mean, you must wake up earlier than the bishop so that he finds you in the church. That is what happens. So he was the first part of the pastor. He was sent to go and work with the bishop. And because bishop and some hints about the life of this seminarian, he never said anything. All the movements of the bishop, going for anything in the parishes, he was with the bishop. He was like the personal secretary. Did he behave well? He didn't. Number one, he was not able to wake up at 5 and go to church with the bishop. Number two, when the bishop tells him, we meet at the parking at 8, so that we go to the parish A, B, and C, he goes late. So bishop leaves him. And then he takes a board. You know, this time we have board aboard, eh? They fail you very fast. They take you whatever you want very quickly. So then the first part of his transfer finished. And the bishop said, gentlemen, you just go home. I want to pray for you. Whatever God tells me to do, I'll do it for you. If he tells me to ordain you, I'll ordain you. If he tells me to support you to do a degree in the what we call this now, secular world, just do the degree. So now yesterday he called me. He said, Father, how are you? Fine. You remember me? I said, see, you come from Meru, my place. So we know each other quite well because you are also my student. He told me, how was the report of assessment? I told him, that is my secret and our secret. We don't reveal these things. You get the report from the diocese. But one thing about you is called Anderson, anyway. But one thing about you, Anderson, you are very cheeky. You are not open at all. And I am fearing you become a priest and behave the way you have been behaving in the seminary with all the support we gave you, the counseling, spiritual direction. If you become a priest that way, I don't think you'll be able to live for priesthood. Because the priesthood demands a lot. It demands a lot. Number one, you'll be lonely. Because you're alone until you get used to. Like me, I don't like much companies. I am now used to staying alone. Bwana Yesu asifiwe. Bwana Yesu asifiwe. I am very much used to staying alone. The first 2 years in my priesthood, I was feeling like leaving the priesthood. Uko nyumba peke yako, mpishi anapika anaenda, TV iko pale. Sasa unakula peke yako, mara nyingine unakula kidogo because no appetite when you are alone. And so I told him, you listen to the bishop. What he tells you to do, you do it. We must start shining when we are young. Don't wait until you are 50 years like me, or like many of us who are here. Don't wait until you get married so that you can become salt and light to the world. Don't wait until you go to college. Start now. Cultivate virtues at this particular time. And the hundreds of challenges on the way, because nobody is a saint, you'll be able to live your life with your ups and downs. Ups and downs, because God will be supporting you. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. Thank you, Jesus, for these ones. Jesus, we trust in you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We now arise for the profession of faith. I believe in one God, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God,
With the whole church, we say, enlighten us, O Lord. For our Pope, Bishop, priests, and deacons, that their preaching of Christ may not be done in lofty words and human wisdom, but rather in the power of the Spirit. Let us pray to the Lord. For all the baptized, that they may be the salt of the earth and the light of the world, through the joyous witness of the Christian life and by reaching out to those in need. Let us pray to the Lord. For the peace in the world, that all the nations, guided by the Holy Spirit, may seek ways of ending all conflicts and wars while building up peaceful relationships. Let us pray to the Lord. For the homeless, the hungry, the sick, the orphans, and the afflicted, that they may receive consolation and hope from God and the material support they need from our generosity. Let us pray to the Lord. For the religious communities, that they may live their vocation and mission in such a way that all people may see their good works carried out in love and give glory to the Father. Let us pray to the Lord. Amen. For Christian communities, that they may be the salt of the earth and the light of the world through the witness of the community life. Let us pray to the Lord. Amen. For ourselves and our dear ones, that our Sunday celebration may strengthen us in our discipleship and help us to be true witness of the risen Lord in our daily life. Let us pray to the Lord.
Merciful Father, make the light of the gospel shine in the whole world through our prayers and visitors, so that all people
prayer for a synodal church. We stand before you, Holy Spirit, as we gather together in your name, with you alone to guide us. Make yourself at home in our hearts. Teach us the way we must go and how to pursue it. We are weak and sinful. Do not let us promote disorder. Do not let ignorance lead us down the wrong path, nor partiality influence our actions. Let us find in you our unity, so that we may journey together to eternal life, and not stray from the way of truth and what is right. All this we ask you, who are at work in every place and time, in the communion of the Father, the Son, forever and ever. Amen.
Oh,
in a similar way when it's presented in the churches. And once more, giving that, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in the memory of me."
Thank you.
that we may dwell in Christ, we may joyfully bear fruit for the salvation of the world. For we ask in this, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Peace to love and serve the Lord.